Okay, I will speak about how I use roguelikes to teach my students Python. If any one of you is interested in Python yourself or in teaching Python, please use the time and install Python 3 on your device, because later I will try to do some live coding and you can participate. So it's maybe interesting for you. Okay. It worked 5 minutes ago. I cannot. Ah, yeah. Okay. I'm from Vienna, Austria. It's also a city at the Danube. And I'm exactly here. I have a little afternoon school, so I'm self-employed, and I work as a teacher, like if you're a music teacher, but I teach coding. Sometimes I go into schools and make workshops there, like here with a pocket code for app programming, but usually I don't do that, not because I don't like it, but because they don't pay me. So I prefer if students come to my place, this is my office, and I get paid, and I teach them coding. I was growing up I'm born 1970, I grew up with a Commodore 64 computer, and what fascinated me was little games where little sprites move around and things explode, and so that's basically the thing I try also to teach my students. I mostly use Python and PyGIM because it's easy for teaching, and mostly we make stuff that explodes, like you see here all these fragments, that's all fragments from one explosion, so my students really like that. And usually the students come to me 2 hours a week, every week. But in the summer and in the vacations, I make something like little summer schools. So the students come to me 3 hours a day in the morning from 9 till 12 for 5 days, and then come the next class. So I have a block of 15 hours with some students like that. Groups are around 5 to 10 people. And I discovered that this kind of games that I like doing are too complex for a 15-hour workshop. So I had not much success with that. And I needed another thing, what I can do with my students. So I discovered, yeah, I always love playing roguelikes. I'm a dungeon crawl player since many years. I have never won. And why don't make roguelikes with my students to teach them coding and to have a fascinating project for them. And first I was a bit scared. I think, okay, the students need, my students are, by the way, between 10 and 15 years old mostly. I need better graphics for them that they will not like if I do something in text mode, but it turned out they're very happy with the text mode, so it's no problem for them at all. Also, I do most of my things so that they also work on a Raspberry Pi, because some of my students have them. And I like if it's all open source based. Yeah, I discovered something. One is I have a Python snake in my office. It's from a FOSTEM conference in Belgium. It's actually from some prop from a zoo, but they gave it to me at the Python boot of a conference and have it in my office. And one of the things I learned is that if the students put it on their head, like this one, yeah, then the code way better. So it's a side effect of having fascinating stuff in your office. You see this student really relaxed and not worried. And also this student, he also watched the other one, but is happy that he can have a snake on his head. I never understood it, but I use it. Okay, yeah, another thing that I learned just by basic teaching is here you can see a level design. This is a dungeon, actually, with a very interesting mushroom shape that a student builded. So he was against rectangular levels. Another thing I learned is that if you're not doing block-based programming, but instead really typing, so Python with text-based, I feared that somehow boring for them because it's only text and they are young. And then I discovered it is boring for them, like if you have a terminal like that and they must type, they're not overly fascinated. But then by accident, I use mostly Linux, this have seen my terminal. My terminal always looks like that, so I have a green font color. And then the student said, yeah, you know, I want also use Linux. And I said, why you want Linux? You have a Windows computer. Yeah, because I want to use the terminal. Then I explained to them, look, also on Windows, you can use your terminal. And they said, yeah, but it's not like that. So in the end, I found out what the students really want is a green font on a black background, because then they're hacking. So they're hackers. So, and of course, now all my Linux computers have a terminal with a green font on a black background to make them really happy. Okay, this is a usual setting, and this is one of my summer classes. And you see here these little icons. This is also one turn of a turn-based game, but several turns displayed on the same screen. So we have no clear screen command here. So they make a turn, next turn, next turn. And for the students that they were happy enough, I discovered that what the students most like is if they make something that is so fascinating that they can show it to their friends and learn from each other, like the first speaker told us about the dolphins who teach each other games. So also my students like to teach each other stuff that they know and have fun each other. So the less I do, the more happy they are. If I try to organize fun for them, they more feel like in school. So they are in a situation where they have to obey or have to do what I say. And for them it's most fun if they can show off each other something. Look what I found fascinating. So I try to recreate situations like that where the students can learn from themselves. Another side effect is, this is also a summer school of me. You see here's a green font, a black terminal. Sometimes a student is stuck, like this one. You can see at his facial expression that he has a problem, maybe reading an error message or something. You can also see that all the other students are quite busy, and his cousin or sister is very happy because she was paying attention previously, and now she has solved the problem. And if ever one of you is in a teaching situation where you have more than one student, like a group, yes, you know it only needs one lagging behind student to ruin the progress of the whole group. So one is, why is my screen not working, or why is my mouse not left clicking, and you have to stop. You go to him, you have to interact with him. Meanwhile, all the very carefully build up tension so that you have the attention of the whole room is destroyed, and every student begin playing with each other or with a smartphone and so on. Then you have to restore order again, restore silence so that you can speak again. So it's really annoying. Yes, I found out the best thing is if somehow I manage that the students can either fix their own problems, or that the students who are a bit advanced can help the lagging behind students. Because what I like most is that if one student has an intelligent question, like how we introduce a princess instead of a monster, or how we make exploding walls for our dungeon game, yes, that I can sit down with him and try to explain him and implement this feature while the other students are somehow occupied, but occupied in a sense that I'm not ashamed of, like occupied that they do coding and learn something and not throwing my computers around or something. Okay, so what you see here is if you have one good student like this little girl, then she goes over to her brother and helps him, and you can see from the Okay, I'm missing a picture here. Oh yeah, I missed some pictures here. Yeah, he looks not relieved that maybe the pictures have got mixed up. There's a picture where she's smiling very happy because she could help him. So generally the students are very happy to help when they learn something with coding. Yeah, another thing I learned is I have codes like 100 lines of code, sometimes 400 lines of code that they need for a very basic dungeon crawl game, or so a roguelike game. And how do I put these lines of code into the students' computers? And one obvious way is to prepare that and then just let the children play with the prepared demos. Yes, but this turned out very boring. Another thing is I try to print them out and then hand them over the sheets, and then they glued it on the computers or on each other and type them, so like writing them off paper. And My idea was I want to teach them several things at once. One of them is typing, because most students don't know very good typing. They don't know where the keys are. They never have typed a square bracket. We have German keyboard layout, so that is complicated. They never have typed angel brackets. They don't know. In Python, you need indentation, so that's important. So you have to teach basic typing skill before you can teach programming in a text-based way. And one of my idea was, okay, let them type that, and if they have typed enough, they can test if it runs error-free, and then later I will explain what they actually did. This worked somehow, but it made a very boring class, so they were very silent, and then I could feel it's not their idea of fun to type so much from paper. So what I ended up doing with was, here's the picture I was missing. You see the girl now happy, because she explained and her brother doesn't know. Okay. Yeah, so what I ended up doing was, I dictate the code, like a dictator. So I stay here, usually I have a bit bigger laptop, I write some lines of code, and then I just dictate them vocal, and the others type them. But that way I can see who is lagging behind. They get some English listening skill, and we are more or less at the same pace. I have not found yet the ideal solution for teaching code. But I noted if I use a Beamer and I have the projection there, it also did not work so well. So I was thinking this is the best method, that you have just text on the Beamer projected, and the students will type it on their own, but somehow it also distracted them. My result is I have no ideal method for teaching larger blocks of code. At the moment, I dictate them and go around and always make sure that nobody is lagging behind and that they can type up from each other. Okay. I have I have prepared some code examples. I hope I can later show them you on the other computer that is now prepared. Some insights that I found while teaching is it's better to start with very, very small game that is maybe like five lines of code, yes? And then the students has a chance to grasp, understand that intellectually, and see that a block is moving around. And from that I can build up. If I start with 100 lines and say you typed it, and then we have a working game and it can do that and that, it was too much. So then they just accepted it as a black box, that's something I have to do, and then I can play with it. But they had not a feeling of ownership. I don't own the code because I don't understand each line. So I start with very, very small pieces. Yes, with very small pieces, just that a character is moving left to right. And that can write that as like 10 lines of code in a reasonable time. I can understand that and then can build up from that. So really start with very small steps. That was one message. Another thing is to find the sweet spot of each student. For me, this, as a teacher, as a teacher who only get paid if the students come. If they don't come, I make no money. So the sweet spot is if the students are so engaged and so happy in this, what they know at the moment and what they can modify of their own, that they don't need me. Or they only need me if they have a very special question that they can solve for their own. So I'm acting like a living biological man page. Yes? And I try to create situations where I have taught them enough so that they can now implement their own ideas without bothering me too much. So that's what I try, and if they are in this status, I don't touch them basically. I think, okay, if I feel they get bored, I will teach them more advanced concept, and if not, I just let them there. Yes, teaching typing, and very, very important, teach them how to read the error message, because the standard answer from a student I get is, it does not work. And then I say, why it does not work? What the computer says exactly? I did not read that. And so the fact that you have to read an error message, and there's the line number, and maybe an error description, and then that you have to try to interpret this error message, that's something I try to teach them. Also what I learned is that children are no adults at all, so their idea of fun is somehow different than my idea of fun. Like the idea of fun is like pressing very rapidly, very often and very loud on a key and see what happens. Yes, or if you have a hit point system, they want to see what happens if I have 1 billion of hit points. So working with extremely large numbers, so that makes no sense for me, and it's also not funny because I can say, yeah, well, you will never die, it will be a boring game. But he had not made this experience, maybe because he only get ready-made games who does not have this feature. So maybe that's the experience they have to do, what is boring, how can I find limits. So I let them do that, and then I know they learn way better if they teach each other. And what they often say me, literally they say, Horst, less talking, more coding. So they want having a feature, but they really don't want to my theory what we have to do to make that. Like if I say, okay, you want a moving monster, I must teach you about classes and object orientation. And they say, no, don't teach, just tell us what to write, and they want this written, and then later on I have a chance to actually explain them what they did. But they want the results first, they want to play with it first, and then later understand it. Yeah, that's what I wrote here. So I try to do, when they ask me something, usually it's only one student who has a question, then I speak with them, and with the others I'm just happy if they code and if they reach their goals. My final advice is it's for my life situation, so I make money with that. But if you think it's a cool job, like you're getting paid to play computer games with children, it's not so cool. Get a real job instead. The downside is that your parents are full of shame, and if they want to break with their children's career, then they say, yeah, our son, yeah, he's very old now, but he still plays computer games, only sometimes with other children. So it's it's not something that make your parents proud. Okay. That was it, more or less. I try now to go to a practical part. If you have a laptop with Python installed, Python 3 installed, please try to open it. Open Python, and I will just show you my code. Yeah, that's the best.
Tell me my shell, and you have not installed,
yeah.
So you can...
Have you... Yeah. Okay, so I have it all in a GIST repository. You will later get the link also. So all what I show you is of course prepared. What I made here is a is a little Python program. You can see here the dungeons, and it has moving monsters and classes and everything. But of course, it's a bit long, so it has several hundred lines. And it's not even a perfect Python program, so there's code on module level. Like, that's what I wanted to do, but it's here line 426, so that's a bit much for a small workshop. It's doable in several days, but maybe not if you have only one afternoon. Yeah? So my point is, start way smaller, and I made here a one-dimensional dungeon, and it has only 26 lines. Yes, and this is the example that I found work best. This is actually an expanded version. Here is border controls. You see here there's a wall. Here is also a wall, and between are flue elements. So this is a one-dimensional dungeon, a corridor, basically. And we have a hero, and the hero is controllable by the keys A and D. Yes, that's the code. I will try to run it in a terminal and show you.
Yeah. So, okay, if you have Python, you just here open a new file. Okay, and save it as with a Py extension. Making him move around. Also, if I now go left, he will run into the wall. And he says, ouch. Okay? So, because he was running into the wall. Yes? And you see, this is not so much to type. It's the children that I teach, so H10 plus, were very well able to understood nearly all of it, except here, this, and usually I stopped explaining it, I just say, take that, and only if they really wanted to know what happens, I explain it. But they understood very good the keys for the commands, they understood the directions, and they understood what happens if they run into something. The nice thing is here, it's very easy to expand it, like that you can make a stationary monster like guard dog who is chained on a post, and then you can ask, okay, what is if the hero runs not in a wall but into this guard dog, and then you can introduce some very little combat system. So this is actually a very good starting point for teaching, and it's doable in one afternoon or even in 1 hour if you have very limited time but very good students. So that's my the conclusion of my experience of several years of trying to find something that I can teach to young students in limited time. If they get bored of that, if they say, like, yeah, how about the second dimension, then of course you can do that. I made in the Sandbeast a two-dimensional version with a bit better. Yes, here you see, and we have now three levels. Okay, just let me copy it. I need a new file name. And I'm ready to go. Okay, so. And here, you see now that there are different levels with the stair system and the same dungeon door. And here, writing directly in the level, you can run to test, but here's voice inside the level. So this is like the room that you can only enter from the other side. Yeah, of course, the whole thing that gets a bit more complex, but it's still manageable from the time you need for typing. And actually, it's pretty nice because you can then here work with the different directions. Let's see if it works. So, you see here my hero is on the upper left. And he has here a big level. I can run around with him in four directions. Okay, he's moving to the right, and I can move him down. You see he was over the stair, and I go now on the stair, and I try now to go down, and to type down. Please note that I'm now in level 0, and now I'm in level 1. So this level is different than this one. Yes? So actually this was a three-dimensional game, so I have three dimensions in a manageable amount of code. I also made one that it has only two dimensions. That you can see here. The two-dimensional code is 50 lines, and three-dimensional code with different level systems is 85 lines. So I would say 85 lines is between 3 hours. 3 hours of teaching, depending on how big your classroom is and how many students you have and how much experience they have. Yeah, that was it. If you're interested, upstairs I have a big example with classes and everything that can of course do more, but it's all text-based. Like this one has a princess inside, and you don't kill the princess. If the princess and the hero attack, they make drama. So. Messages. That's all right. Amount I try to show you. Here we have the death strike, so there's a little combat system with very sophisticated. Me personally, I love creating combat systems with dices or percentages or for double hit or critical hit and so. And I noticed that for the students it's not so fascinating like for me. So. They're also completely happy with just a random number system like points or so. And here you see, this is the death strike, and then this is the strike, and here we have the death grammar. I think you can figure it out yourself. Good. So far to my speech. I hope you liked it.
Okay, there were two questions. The last one was the time frame from knowing nothing to being able to create. As I showed you before, the 500 line example is doable with good students in 1 week or 3 hours, five times, as I said, after 15 hours. It's doable, and then you have really a workable roguelike game with classes, also with moving monsters. The monsters move around, but all text-based and a little combat system. And what the students love to do is introduce very exotic things to pick up, like loot or different kind of food, but also like, you know, this Bomberman game or Sobukan games where you basically can destroy walls in a level. It's a different kind of game, but they say to me, "Yo, look, I want to pick up dynamite, and then the dynamite should blow away all the walls around me." So we did that, and that was for me interesting. So if they ask for features that I would not have thought of. Yeah. But I would say, at least, I doubt that it's you can do much faster such a complex game than 15 hours. Maybe if you have only one or two students and they have prior knowledge, then you maybe manage 10 hours or so. Was this answering your questions?
Yes, thank you.
How do I begin?
Yeah. What are the first steps?
Silence. That's the first steps. Throw out your chewing gums. Yeah, I tried explaining before, if I start teaching too long and they have nothing to do, they get unresty. So what I try to do is really dictate them, usually with the one-dimensional examples, dictate them, you type that, this key is there. So really make them type their 10 lines of code, and if they've done that and then they see something magically moves because they give the command and they are able to play their own game, then they're really happy, and then this is was this one-dimensional code example. That's usually in a week, if I only have 1 week and I don't know the students, where how I start. And I try to display the code example. What? Here, you see, it fits on one screen. This is doable, even if you have several students. I suppose you have more students than I do. I will not scale. But as a beginning point, I will do that. Usually, I let out the walls and I let out the security check. So what the students then do is they move around, move back, and then they move in the invisible space. They move away and typing, and the guy is not dead, but also not here. And then they bring him back from the abyss, also from the negative X value, bring him back. And of course, because they are boys, they hit like 10,000 times in a minute and then try to, if he really comes back. Yeah, yes. Not all of them, but I have, this summer I had like 3 girls and the rest were boys, so below 10%.
There was a question here?
Yeah, why I use text and not colorful like Pygame graphics. I was trying actually for several years to do exactly that because I feared that text will be too boring. And I discovered that it is not, that the children have far more fantasy and far more ability to find some characters fascinating. If I say to them, look, this D is now a big dragon, and then they can play along with them endlessly and have fun. I forgot to tell that. The children have most fun, even if they're not so well with coding, they have very much fun to just design levels. And I'm very happy if I see that. Like, if I make that for them, and then they discover, okay, if I put a big D here inside, it's a dragon, and then the next thing they do is creating a big room full of dragons. And then they challenge each other to play it, and then of course they die, and that's, I think that's boring. But for them it's not boring. It's like, wow, I can make a room full of dragons. And then the next thing they ask me is, how do I get 1 million hit points to survive the room full of dragons? So, yeah, but I learned, so okay, there's something they somehow need for their learning process, so I give them that. But I can assure you it's not boring, but you must make a green font on a black background. Yeah.
How do you feel their experience of playing games influences what they want from your class and whether they change your class?
Well, this is a generation problem because I grew up with home computers in the 70s, yes. So I think the students are full of crap and their game is full of proprietary crap and they should play real open source game like Dungeon Crawl, but that's my feelings to what, because sometimes they show me what they play like commerce written games with flashy graphics but with no in depth.
Yeah, my question was, I guess they come to your class expecting to learn programming,
Yeah. Let's say some students really want to learn programming because they have a website in mind or some other application in mind, and most students have only game programming in mind. So that's what I sell them. Yeah. 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 Yeah, that was, I was wondering that self, and I helped my adapt, because previously I always tried some starting with Blender, with the Blender game engine, because it's three-dimensional or something else to get them optically fascinated. And I discovered that it's not necessary, because they're far better than me in having fun with just text.
Do you show them roguelikes before you begin, or how do you learn
working? I show them?
Roguelikes,
it depends on the time I have with them. If they are regular students who come to me every week, I of course show them the games I play, and say to them, look, well, this is an open source game. We can import all the graphics from it and we can modify it. But in the intense courses, I usually don't have the time. Yeah. For some it is, yeah. And actually, none of them has experience with text-based games anymore, because they don't play adventure games, they don't play RPGs. Yeah. Yeah.
Do you have any impact on helping
to
get more girls?
No, this is $1 million question in my country, and personally, I would give you another $1 million, because then I will double my income if I got more girls. My explanation is that either I suck or the society. So, but most of the clients I get are boys. What I discovered, because sometimes I have girls like in the 10% range, is that they're usually more focused and pay more attention to the teacher and are more faster able to solve a given problem or solve a given task. What I also discovered is that like if I make free trial day for girls, or there's from the city of Vienna has a daughter's day where we are going to schools, that despite their capability, also they have the skills, yes, they're able to do that, but they simply don't have the interest. Like if this workshop is over, they say and then they wander off, yes, and the girls that somehow become my customers are usually very nerdy girls, and I discovered some relationship into manga. So they often show me they draw mangas. So I think that that's something in my culture. If you live in a German-speaking country and are fascinated in a young age with Japanese comic culture, you somehow, how should I say, you are able to not streamline hobbies. You understand me? So you have a fascination with exotic things, and then those also do well with coding. Yeah.
Would this approach work on adults?
I must. Maybe I suck there even more than I suck with getting more female students, but I teach adults like 20 years for doing Microsoft Excel for office workers and stuff. But to teach coding to adults, the bitter truth is if you are adult and you want to learn coding and you're not really very motivated by yourself, it's probably too late. So I don't, look, I have a business few on them, yes. There comes one, and they come often, and they say, "Yeah, coding is so fascinating, and I'm not satisfied with my job, and maybe I should start coding, and then I can make a better career." And then I think, well, you're now 30 something, and you have a wife, you have children, you have not much time, and I don't see them coming to my lessons very often, no matter how cheap I do them, even if I do them for free. It's more speak and less doing. It's like if someone say, "Yeah, I want to become Schwarzenegger and train a lot of muscles." I think you all have such friends. Usually they stay fat. What works is that there's a jobless agency in Austria. So they pay you if you fall out of job, you get courses paid, And if this agency paid the course, then it's not the money of the student. And then he comes and makes the course and is usually very fascinated by it. But as soon as this money transfer ends, he does not come anymore. That's basically my experience.